Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to Ihkam SOS Ramadan Special. My name is Mohsin Shah and wishing you all a happy Ramadan, Ramadan Kareem. Joining me on today's show is Sheikh Ali Ma. Assalamu alaikum, Sheikhna.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.
How's your fasting going?
Alhamdulillah. Taqabbalallahu alaikum.
Wa antum, inshallah. Sheikhna, let's begin with what is fasting? I mean, we discussed the meaning of fasting and its roots, but what is fasting? What does it mean for one to fast?
أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وصلى الله على محمد وآله الطيبين الطاهرين
اللهم صل اللهم صل.
Fasting is abstaining and refraining from eating and drinking and from breaking your fast from the time of Adhan al-Fajr, when the Mu'adhin says Allahu Akbar, you cannot eat anything else. From Adhan al-Fajr, the morning pray, till Adhan al-Maghrib. Between these two periods, you're not allowed to eat or drink anything. So that is actually the meaning of fasting is. Now, to add on that, it's not just to refrain eating and drinking, as I've mentioned in the previous episodes. You have to also have the intention, the niyyah, for the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to get closer and to seek nearness to Allah, the Almighty. That's important, because fasting is ibadah, is worship. So you must have with the ibadah, with any ibadah, any worship, the pure intention, the right intention for the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's very important, that we don't encounter fasting is just to refrain from eating and drinking, but also to have the intention that it is for the cause of Allah. We are obeying Allah. We are trying to apply Allah's commands on earth. So by praying, by going to Hajj, by fasting and so forth, that's very important.
So Sheikhna, is fasting in Ramadan, is this the only type of fasting, or is there other types of fasting that we have throughout the year?
Well, the fasting may fall in four categories in the Ahkam. So we have the wajib, obligatory fasting.
Okay.
You have the forbidden, the haram fasting.
Oh wow.
And you have the makruh fasting, and you have the mustahab fasting. So four Ahkam for the fasting.
So we actually have fasting that you're not allowed to do, like haram, you're not allowed to do it. What, isn't this like saying, isn't fasting like a good act and an act to bring you closer to God? How can it be made haram?
Well, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the wise, he authorizes and he legislates this hukum, then we have to abide. If okay. He says this type of fasting is haram, then we have to abide. And Allah has the wisdom and the hikmah for making such rules and ahkam with regard to forbidding fasting or making it obligatory. So he is the wise for that. And let's begin with the obligatory fasting. So the month of Ramadan is one of them, and the main ones, the wajib and obligatory fasting. And also if you do nadr or oath, that also makes your fasting wajib. You have to fulfill this okay. Nadr or this oath, ahad. So that's the wajib, the main wajib, obligatory siyam and fastings. The forbidden ones are the ones in which you are not allowed to fast. The fasting is void, it's batil, okay. And it's haram. You did.
So you'll be punished for fasting on this day?
Of course, because you're disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says to you, don't fast on this day, which is the Eid al-Fitr and Eid al-Adha. Two okay. Eids, main Eids in the year, you're not allowed to fast. So if you disobey Allah, you'll get the sin, of course.
Okay, mashallah, Sheikhna, we have wajib and we have haram. What about mustahab and makruh? And do we have a mubah fast as well?
Well, with regard to mustahab, there are certain days in the year that you can fast. It's mustahab. Let's say the beginning of the month, the lunar, the Hijri month,
okay,
and the middle of the month and the last day of the month, for example. You have also to fast mustahab all the month of Rajab and Sha'ban.
Okay, mashallah.
Yes, some of the pious believers used to fast the two months continuously, and they link it to Ramadan. So they fast Rajab, Sha'ban, and of course Ramadan. So 90 days, roughly 90 days, they observe fasting. And there are great thawab and great rewards are given for those who fast as a mustahab in the month of Rajab and Sha'ban. You can find them in the books of Ad'iyah, like Mafatih Jannah and so forth, that fasting one day, what is the reward of that one day fasting? 2 days, 3 days, and so forth. So it's very important that we observe also fasting the mustahab. The mustahab fasting itself prepares the mu'min, the believer, to begin the month of Ramadan with confidence, without any issues. Mm-hmm. You know, it won't harm him when he starts the first day of Ramadan. Unlike if you don't fast the month of Rajab and the month of Sha'ban, and then you straight away begin the fasting of the first day of month of Ramadan, it would be difficult for some people.
Mm.
So the month of Rajab, Sha'ban, preparation.
Okay.
For the fasting of the month of Ramadan, for the ibadah, for prayers, everything.
So it gives you practice.
Some kind of practice, bodily, spiritually, gives that chance to train yourself for the fast and for the ibadah and for the forthcoming of the holy month of Ramadan. And of course, we have the makruh, the disliked fasting, and which is the day of Ashura.
Okay.
It is makruh for the one to make the intention from the Fajr to the Maghrib of fasting that day. Unlike some or the majority of the Sunni sects that they actually have that day, sadly, they fast as a, you know, thanking Allah for saving Musa alayhi salam from such and such. They have their own narrations, which we don't accept it. And we've been encouraged by Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam that we don't fast this day. But what we can do on this day, the day of Ashura, to refrain from, let's say, eating till the dhuhr time or the afternoon time. And then you drink a cup of water, you eat something, dates, for example.
Okay.
Just to commemorate that event.
So because at the time of the Battle of Karbala on Ashura, Imam Hussein's camp, alayhi salam, his camp, they didn't have any food or water. So I guess it's in a way just to remember what they were going through and to understand how hungry they were on the plains of Karbala. And it wasn't until about Dhuhr as the time anyway.
The problem with the fasting, that it is some kind of sign of joy and thanking Allah.
Okay.
So like some of the Bani Umayyah, they fasted on that day as thanking Allah that they became victorious against Al-Husayn alayhi salam, for example. So it is a makruh. We have to refrain from fasting this day, and we just have to refrain from eating too much food on that day, just to show the sorrow and the grievance.
I see. Okay. Not
by having just a cup of, let's say, tea or water.
To show that you are grieving.
Exactly.
But to make the intention
of fasting, that is what we have been discouraged to do so.
Shaykhuna, who is fasting obligatory upon? I mean, who must fast?
Well, fasting the holy month of Ramadan is obligatory for every Muslim, male and female, but with one or two conditions, that they have to be sane, aqil, and they have to be baligh. They have reached the age of adolescence and puberty. That's very important. So the ahkam, the worships and the ibadat will be accepted and taken into consideration by reaching in that age and that period of bulugh. And of course, that doesn't mean that if a child in the age of, a boy, let's say, in the age of 12, 13, he wants to fast. Ulama say that, some ulama, that his a'mal also accepted. He gets the reward, his parents get the reward, for example. But it's not counted as, you know, a proper fasting or a proper prayers, because the wajib becomes wajib when they reach the age of adolescence and bulugh.
Bulugh, okay.
And the malaika start to write the hasanat and sayyat and the wajib and so forth. So that is the where the fasting becomes wajib upon the Muslim male or female. And of course, with regard to the age of bulugh, the age of bulugh and adolescence for the female when she completes the lunar, the Hijri calendar, the age of 9. When she completes 9, entering the year 10, then she becomes baligha and she must do the ibadat as her parents do, as a normal and ordinary adults do the ibadat, they have to do as well. And for the boys, when they complete the lunar and the Hijri year of 15.
Okay, 15 years lunar calendar, using the lunar
exactly,
calendar.
Exactly, yeah, for the male. And that's important. Of course, for the male, sometimes it is earlier, sometimes in the age of 13, 14, yes. Depending on the signs of the bulugh. That's important. Yes. But that's the max. If the boy didn't see or notice any alama, any sign, then they have to wait till the 15, they complete the 15 age, and then they start the wajibat act and so forth.
Sheikh, what happens when we have a young girl, let's say she's 10 years old now, she's reached the age of bulugh, and it's summertime, the fasts are extremely long for her. Is it mandatory and wajib for her to fast?
You see, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a merciful Lord, and when He legislated these ahkam and rules, He did them with His wisdom, with His hikmah, and with His knowledge. Mm-hmm. So when He said subhanahu wa ta'ala that the female should become wajib on her, the prayers, fasting, and so forth, in such age, then He knows, subhanahu wa ta'ala, that she is able, capable in that age, unlike the boy.
Yes.
She is able. However, to begin with, the first year, we shouldn't actually press too much on the girls to, you know, you must khalas fast. You know, no, if she can't, then khalas, she breaks her fast. And there are ahkam for this,
okay,
for this
which
case.
We'll discuss probably later in
future
episodes.
You know, drink the water, for example, if she can't bear the fasting, and then she do the qada, for example, afterwards, okay, without kafara, for example, mm-hmm, and so forth. So there are ease issues and ahkam with this regard. So Islam is, again, as I've said, a merciful religion. So it won't ask the person to fast, and she must observe fasting, you know, with no regret, with no mercy, no.
Ahsan, Sheikh. Now, Sheikh, you were talking about fasting happens from the Fajr Adhan till the Maghrib Adhan. Now, does this mean as soon as the Adhan is spoken and read, that is when it begins, you have to stop eating there and then? Or can you let the Adhan run, carry on eating, and when the Adhan finishes, that's when you can stop eating? Or should we actually stop eating in Imsak?
Well, the ahkam here, as the Sayyid says, that it is mandatory to refrain from eating and drinking just shortly before the Adhan of Fajr.
Okay.
So you have to give a few minutes before that to make sure that you have fulfilled your fasting and you have refrained from eating and drinking while the time is due for the Adhan. So just a few minutes before the Adhan, you have to stop, as we have seen in some of the calendars in the month of Ramadan. They have the Imsakiyah. So mm-hmm, Imsak 10, 15 minutes before that. And of course, we have to also break the fast just a few minutes or just shortly after the Adhan and Maghrib, just shortly. So again, to fulfill the fact that we have observed fasting correctly from the Adhan al-Fajr till the Maghrib time. So you have a perfect fasting with no issue of timing. So you won't fall into the mas'ala and the issue that, well, did I break my fast before the Adhan in, let's say, 1 minute? Or,
okay,
you know, sometimes it happens. You know, some people would straight away break their fast, you know, puts the dates in his mouth. By the second Mu'addin says Allahu Akbar, for example.
Yes.
You know, the Mu'addin, although he's accurate, but not always you can rely on the Adhan 100%. You know, they are at the end of the day, people like me and you, we might make mistakes and
yes,
we might do the Adhan. So we have to make sure that we give it a little bit of time, more time, just a short bit of time, after the Adhan, and then we break the fast.
Hassan Sheikhnab, thank you very much, and thank you to all our viewers for joining us on today's show. Inshallah, you'll be joining us throughout Ramadan as we'll be looking at different ahkam rules in regards to Sawm and fasting. Until next time, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh.